Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm delighted to welcome you here today to this intergenerational inquiry on Youth and Public Empowerment Day at COP26. My name is Sophie Dowd, and I'll be the co-moderator for today's dialogue.
Hello, everyone. I'm Disha Sarkar, and I'm a member of the ACE Working Group of YOUNGO. I'm also a representative of the Global Youth Development Institute, and I'm very happy to co-moderate today's event.
Lovely. I'd like to thank all of you for joining us here today, both in this room and online. For everyone who's joining us, I would like to let you know that we will be having guests speaking in a variety of languages. So if you haven't already picked up a headset for simultaneous translation, I'd encourage you to do so. This is the second event hosted by YOUNGO on Youth and Public Empowerment Day. Our first event at 10 o'clock was the presentation of the Global Youth Statement to esteemed leaders from both within the COP Presidency, the UN FCCC with Patricia Espinosa and COP President Alok Sharma, as well as the First Minister of Scotland and other esteemed guests. That was a real moment for us to champion the voice of young people to decision makers. What we want to have now is more of a dialogue, of a discussion, of a conversation. We're really excited to be having a more in-depth inquiry with our incredible panel of guests. But that also applies to you as our audience members. We'd really like to encourage each and every one of you to think of great questions that you have for our speakers, as there will be time at the end of this for questions and answers. And we do really want this to be a dialogue and a conversation. So, without further ado, I would like to introduce our esteemed guests today. Minister Erica Muñez, Minister for Foreign Affairs at the Republic of Panama. I would like to introduce Minister Roberto Cingolani, Ecological Transition Minister and sponsor of the Youth for Climate event this year in Italy. Sophie Howe, Future Generations Commissioner for Wales. Jane Goodall, Primatologist and Anthropologist. Jayathma Wickramanayake, UN Secretary General Envoy on Youth. And Fleur Newman, the Youth and Gender Lead at the UNFCCC. I'd also like to introduce our incredible youth panelists, Hayley Campbell, Jin Tanaka, Natalie Mangondo, Gabby Costa, and Vikram Mali, who will be all participating in today's dialogue. So that's the introduction all set. We are looking forward to a fantastic conversation with our guests and with you, our audience. Disha, I'll hand over to you for our first section.
Thank you so much, Sophie, for the incredible introduction of our panelists. I believe that today we have a house full of luminaries, and we will look forward to talking with them. So we move forward to our first theme, that is national and international youth participation. So my first question is to Ms. Erica Muñez, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Republic of Panama, about what do you think is the importance of youth and meaningful youth participation in the decision-making process? And how has the government of Panama done successfully in this endeavor?
Thank you. It is wonderful to be here, especially on Youth Day, so we're very grateful for the opportunity. I think it is absolutely crucial to include young, the newer generations are at the ones that will suffer all the consequences and all the decisions that we have to take today. So not having a seat at the table is so far leading to where we are, where we are at a state of urgency, and so far we have not taken the decisions that we need in order to change course. And the government of Panama has taken this very seriously. I am a young Minister of Foreign Affairs, a woman. I know a thing or two about being disregarded and not being given a seat at the table. We not only believe, because I hear often speeches about we have to include them or we've brought them in the delegation. Panama's leading negotiating team are all young. We have, in fact, the youngest delegation of negotiators. Our average age is 27. 60, thank you. they've done an extraordinary job. I think that they succeeded in stating and very clearly that they are powerful. They know what they're doing. They've studied the subject much more, I think, than their counterparts. So I think that you cannot just say, yes, I'll bring somebody because symbolic and you'll have somebody sitting with you and the delegation for a photo op. You have to give them the microphone, and that's what Panama has done. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Erica. I believe the government of Panama will be the torchbearer for involvement of youth in meaningful way. My question to our youth panelist, Mr. Jean Tanaka, you have been working with the government of Japan. What has worked well for you, and what are the barriers that you faced during your involvement as a youth in the process of getting involved with your government?
Okay, thanks so much. So, my name is Jean Tanaka, I'm from Japan, and thanks for the giving questions. And I'd like to answer that there are some many workings we've made through the, some lawmakings and collaboration with the government, companies with enforcing to the environmental conservations and setting up the new areas, like setting to the geopark and eco park and so on. And we got a good result to cooperate with my country's government, but also we have some few barriers. I'd like to mention two main barriers. First is the decision-making process. Now we do the many working, like with the food energies, ocean conservations, climate change, everything we do, but most of them we try to get exchange some ideas with some bureaucrats, politicians, but still we could not get into the decision-making process, cooperating to the international governments. So we should enforce to get into the decision-making process for all of the process we do it. And the second one is we need to get the fundings. Likewise, most of the youth are working for the voluntary, and even here, many youth comes here, but they try to fund by themselves, and they can to contribute by fundings. So it's time to switch to the youth to for voluntary to get offshore jobs to contribute more sustainability for all of the persons who work to engage onto the environmental conservations. So that's the 2 points I like to mention. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Jean Tanaka, for your incredible insight. I would like to ask if anyone has any insights on this. Do you have any views that you want to share as youth activists or as youth advocates working in your own communities with regard to how your involvement has been with your government and what are the barriers that you faced in your process? Okay, seeing none, I would like to pass on to my co-moderator, Sophie, to go on to the second theme. Over to you.
Thank you, Disha. Thank you so much to the Minister and to Jin for those reflections on youth participation in decision-making, and I do hope many of you will come up with some thoughts as we're discussing further. I'm now going to turn to Sophie Howe, the Future Generations Commissioner for Wales. Sophie, we've interacted a few times through my role in the Future Leaders Network here in the United Kingdom. And what I wanted to discuss with you a little bit was the theme for today is an intergenerational dialogue. But how useful is the generation lens? How useful is it to look at the problem of climate change through younger generations and older generations? Does that risk creating division when we should be creating unity to tackle the shared problem that's ahead of us? And in addition, what does intergenerational justice mean to you?
Thank you. I'm delighted to be with you this afternoon. I think to the question, we can't help but consider the intergenerational dimension around climate change. It's an undeniable fact that the current generation and indeed past generations of decision makers have failed future generations. I'd encourage you to read a book by philosopher Roman Knarik called The Good Ancestor. And he talks about the fact that the way in which we've treated the future and future generations is almost that we view it as some distant colony that we don't don't need to worry about. In terms of climate change, of course, we can't even say that we've done that unknowingly. Often when you talk about the future, people are scared of uncertainty and unpredictability. But actually, we've done more damage to the planet since the UN published their first framework of evidence on climate change, since Al Gore published his first Inconvenient Truth, than any other time during human history. So we can't escape the fact that current and past generations have failed future generations, our younger people, and indeed those yet to be born. But that doesn't mean that the solutions need to be divisive solutions. In Wales, we are the first country in the world to have legislated to protect the interests of future generations through our groundbreaking Wellbeing of Future Generations Act. And the simple test of for our decision makers in that act is: demonstrate in your decisions how you are meeting today's needs without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. And it provides a simple toolkit, 5 principles to do that. How is your decision considered the long term? How is it preventing problems from occurring or getting worse? How is it recognising integration, the connections between different policy areas? The fact, for example, that climate justice is a racial justice issue, is a social justice issue, but often those things are not brought together in debate and discussion. How are we working together and how are we involving citizens? And when you apply those tests alongside a set of long-term national wellbeing goals, which we have in our legislation linked back to the UN Sustainable Development Goals, you start to get a different set of decision making. And what you start to see is people looking for the multiple wins across different elements of social, economic, environmental, and cultural well-being, but also between the generations. It's why, for example, our government have chosen to invest in improving the quality of our homes in Wales. That's a multiple win for each generation, because if we improve quality of homes, we reduce our carbon emissions from those homes. If we improve the quality of homes, we keep older people out of hospital during the winter months because they're not in cold and damp homes. If we improve the quality of homes, we take people out of fuel poverty. And if we do that, we also create jobs, which is good for young people, both in the short term and for their success in the long term. So I don't think that meeting the needs of future generations and meeting the needs of current generations is mutually exclusive. What we must do, however, is apply that lens, and we must ensure that every country in the world applies that test of how they are balancing both of those needs, because I think the position that we're in now certainly demonstrates that the balance has tipped unfairly towards the past.
Thank you, Sophie. Thank you. I'd like to turn to Gabby Costa. I'd love to hear your reflections on what intergenerational justice is and how we can deliver intergenerational fairness.
Me gustaría tal vez pedirles que se pongan los audífonos. ¿Me avisan si es que puedo empezar? ¿Puedo empezar? Cuando me preguntan sobre qué pienso de la responsabilidad intergeneracional, pienso en dos conceptos que han marcado mi vida durante mi crecimiento. El uno es la responsabilidad. Aprendí que la responsabilidad es asumir los daños que uno puede causar. Es una relación de causa y efecto que tienes que reparar. Si causas un daño, sea tu pareja o sea en la sociedad, tienes que repararlo. Pienso que esa conexión nos está faltando ahora en los tratados internacionales. Nosotros estamos aquí pidiendo que la coherencia en la que se han comprometido en el futuro que queremos incluya las voces de las juventudes. Se están enfocando en únicamente lo que la ciencia dice, sin tomar en cuenta que tal vez las juventudes desean algo diferente. Otro concepto es la libertad. Donde termina mi libertad es donde empiezan los derechos de alguien más. No estamos reconociendo que todos los que estamos aquí somos productos no solo de la colonización, sino también de la revolución industrial. Tenemos y estamos causando daño incluso a través de los productos que consumimos. Hoy, por ejemplo, tal vez en esta COP sean todos muy felices pensando que no va a haber extracción de petróleo, pero ¿a dónde se va a ir el problema? A la minería. ¿Y quiénes van a sufrir más? Las comunidades indígenas, las comunidades rurales. ¿Por qué? Por la falta de apoyo. ¿Estamos siendo tomados en cuenta? No. ¿Dónde viene mi motivación para poder estar aquí? Inició en Ecuador a través de un proyecto que trataba de vincular a los estudiantes de la universidad con las sociedades rurales, vulnerables, marginalizadas, para que exista un proceso de aprendizaje mutuo. ¿Cuáles fueron nuestras barreras? Financiamiento. Hoy por hoy, el financiamiento climático no llega a las localidades para impulsar las soluciones que ya existen en nuestras localidades. Por eso peleamos por un espacio aquí, que no sea solo palabras el que están incluyendo a la juventud en el futuro, sino que podamos opinar realmente sobre eso. Pero ¿cuáles han sido las barreras que enfrentamos para poder estar aquí? El idioma. Todo el sistema está diseñado para que puedas expresarte únicamente en inglés. Los jóvenes no pueden denunciar las violaciones de derechos humanos en las plenarias, y en nuestros países tampoco lo podemos hacer. Latinoamérica es el país en el que más asesinatos de líderes ambientales existe. Como mujer, ustedes hace como 30 años, cuando dijeron sobre el futuro que queremos y etcétera, se comprometieron también con reglas de la OIT, pero no entiendo cómo tantos recursos, por ejemplo, para dar un ejemplo de incoherencia, se gastan en decoración en esta COP, perdón, es mi primera COP, pero no tengo un lugar para darle de amamantar a mi hija, o no hay un kindergarten, y no entiendo cómo las demás mujeres líderes y los hombres líderes que son parte de una familia no permiten que en un lugar como la COP, que es un lugar de trabajo, no se vean reflejados temas como los compromisos que ustedes han aprobado en el Tratado Mundial del Trabajo, solo para dar un ejemplo. Luego tienen otros tratados de participación, de derechos humanos, etcétera, que no se ven reflejados en esta COP y en otras COP. Nuestro proyecto Unite for Climate Action ha tenido que generar, bueno, gracias, afortunadamente, hemos generado muchas alianzas entre jóvenes activistas europeos, latinoamericanos y caribeños para poder estar aquí a través de herramientas como GoFundMe o influencers o algunas organizaciones que de hecho nos apoyaron a venir acá. Pero venimos a un espacio que no es inclusivo, que no es diverso, ni en el ámbito internacional ni en el local. Este proyecto que les comentaba en el Ecuador que hicimos con universidades para llevar a los estudiantes a tener este vis-a-vis de aprendizaje con las comunidades rurales, ¿por qué no lo pudimos o no lo podemos absolutamente escalar? Porque no tenemos financiamiento, las universidades también tienen recursos limitados. Entonces, ¿qué pasa? Llega un estudiante y encuentra que la comunidad quiere darle valor agregado a sus soluciones en base a la naturaleza, como por ejemplo, algún agregar valor agregado, yo que sé, a la producción de naranjilla para perfumería o para algún producto que sea válido de exportación, y no hay. Todas las iniciativas se enfocan en consultorías. Entonces, esos problemas de coherencia impiden que exista una participación real, no solo en el proceso de decisión internacional y local, sino también en las acciones. Y ahí es en lo que, si quisiera que dar un mensaje, es pedirles que nos apoyen, que nos ayuden y que asuman esta responsabilidad intergeneracional, porque Estamos unidos. Yo soy producto de la colonización, de la revolución industrial y del proceso de producción y de consumo masivo en el que estamos. Gracias.
Thank you so much, Gabby. We actually have a bit of time to dig into that. Sophie, some of the points that you raised in your opening statement was around how intergenerational justice is also gender justice, it is social justice, it is racial justice, and that I think is absolutely what Gabby was talking about there. Would you like to elaborate a bit more about that, and how do we move from just words into actions on delivering justice in this space?
I think that alongside a sort of big problem with short-termism in our systems of politics and governance, there's also a problem with silo-based working. So the fact that, you know, there's a department for the environment, there's a department for equality, there's a department for work, there's a department for housing. Actually, all of those issues are interconnected, and it's probably more important what the Minister for Work does or the Minister for Housing does in terms of climate change, addressing climate change, than it is what the Minister for the Environment does. And so I think that part of the solution to this is a requirement around integrated policy making. And I have to say that I think that requires some fundamental deconstruction of our systems of governance so that we can make these connections. Just yesterday, I published a report looking at future trends and inequalities, and what that identifies is the fact that certainly in terms of the comparisons between the global south and the global north, as we know, those least responsible for climate change are paying the highest price, but that's also the case within our, you know, within the UK. If you are from a black, Asian minority ethnic community, if you are poorer, you are more likely to be living in areas of high air pollution, you're more vulnerable to the risks of flooding, you're less likely to have access to nature. And so the crucial thing around this are requirements built into our systems of governance which require that integrated policy making and that test of long-term versus short-term and how each policy plays out to make a positive contribution across all policy areas and avoids negative impacts.
Thank you, Sophie. I'd like to open up to the rest of our panelists. Is there anything you'd like to add? Absolutely, Minister.
Thank you. I think that Gabby raised some very powerful ideas that we should explore, because there are at least three points that come to mind that are consistent in both positive the protection and that are not reflected at the COP. I think we start by acknowledging that all governments are striving as if the COP was the end, right? So the goal is to get to COP, and COP is not the goal. The goal should be, in our opinion, accountability. Not even commitments, because we come, we commit, we recommit, and we recommit. It should be accountability, and we should be meeting every year to look back into what have we actually done and not what we're planning to do. But there are three groups that are underrepresented, and in the part of accountability, it should be included. The first one, indigenous populations, and hearing I've encountered several that where the story is the same. I didn't even have funds to come here. It was very difficult. I don't have a seat at the table. Indigenous populations that account for 5% protect 80% of the biodiversity in the world. They are the keepers of our land, and they should by default have a seat at the table. The second one, half of the population are women, yet we've all seen the pictures of the leaders that come here. Most of them, I would say 90% are men, old men. That's not a reflection of our planet. There are multiple studies that have, a recent one by the York and Berkeley University that looked at every time that there's a woman leader, she's more likely to sign an agreement when it comes to climate change than men. So it is not just that it's a representation, but also because women are concerned with their children, with generations, they're in tune with the nature as caregivers, that the sense of urgency is there. And the third one the young population that, as we've been saying, are the ones who will be suffering the consequences. There are multiple surveys that show clearly how much more they're in tune, how they understand the urgency of the matter when you go into older excuse of the population. They don't understand the sense of the urgency. So we have a lot of work to do and very little time. We should be meeting to talk about accountability, how all these populations are now truly represented at the table, and I'm pretty sure that we will be making much more meaningful change. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Any of our youth panelists, would you like to share any reflections?
I can add something unless someone else unmuted. I'll talk a little bit more about this a little bit later when it gets to my section of this discussion, but my name's Haley, and I am one of the young people here on the panel. And I'm also a part of YOUNGO's ACE working group, and I think something that's really interesting, and we're talking about inviting more and more people to the table, is the fact that in all of our efforts, you know, this year, last year, to try and push for more youth inclusion, we have been the ones to reach out to negotiators every single time. There's never been a single time for anyone from any party to reach out to us and say, hey, you know, what is your opinion? Or we'd love to talk about youth inclusion with you. It has always been on us, and it is like that for every single community from every different group that is not represented in the negotiations. And I think that's really telling. We have to fight to be included every single time and hope that they listen to us. And sometimes it may seem annoying if I've just sent one person about 20 emails. And I'm sorry, but that's how it is. You know, that's what they get, in my sense, for not including us. So yes, we're going to annoy them, and we're going to share our voices, but it shouldn't just be on us all the time to be in that space, to be continually fighting for our seat at the table. We've proven ourselves, and we shouldn't have had to, but we have, and we deserve to be there, and so do every other group that has just been mentioned during this dialogue.
I think the points that Haley makes really reflects the position that we're advancing, which is why the systems of governance need to change to not make it voluntary that you involve and engage and co-produce with young people, but actually mandatory. We have a youth parliament which sits alongside our Senedd, our national parliament. We have lowered the voting age to 16. And when you lower the voting age and you have a whole batch of new young people who are going to be holding our politicians to account at the ballot box, things start to change. And we also have independent infrastructure through myself as the Future Generations Commissioner and a Children's Commissioner who act as advocates in the interests of children and future generations. So I think that you know, if we're serious about involving young people, it's those governance structures that need to change, and you should not have to be begging for a seat at the table. That seat should be baked in to our governance, to our constitutions, to our political systems.
Para mí es importante que construyamos relaciones que no son tóxicas. El que se siente casi como que no puedas hablar con tu papá. En verdad, estamos en un proceso de decisión de la juventud. Deberíamos ser escuchados. Y la juventud puede, no sé, tengo la impresión de que podemos solucionar las cosas. Algunas cosas pueden tener soluciones ya fáciles de implementar. Por ejemplo, durante la pandemia se generaron muchísimos webinars, muchísima capacitación en inglés. ¿Y qué pasa con todos los latinoamericanos o todas los hispanohablantes que no hablan inglés? Están perdiendo formación política. Ya Naciones Unidas ha invertido dinero en esas capacitaciones, pero no son fáciles de acceder. No están en una plataforma de fácil acceso. Tienes que estar muy metido en el sistema para poder acceder a eso. Solo cambiando eso, ya con iniciativas existentes, ya puedes empezar un cambio. Tener un kindergarten aquí tampoco debería ser difícil. El hecho de que Naciones Unidas tenga reconocidos 7 idiomas, ese ya es un compromiso de que todas las reuniones deberían tener traducción a esos 7 idiomas, por lo menos. Entonces, hay pequeñas cosas que son pasos para ir cambiando todo el sistema, pero no se empieza ni siquiera por ese primer paso.
Thank you so much, and I have to admit, I'm really pleased that we've been able to bring many generations to this table today, and I'm really inspired and empowered by the proactivity of everyone who's spoken and the reflections on that. I'm now going to draw that conversation to a close, and I'm going to hand back over to my co-moderator, Disha, for our next section.
Thank you so much, Sophie, once again. I believe that the panelists have brought forward very different kind of aspects of looking into the same problem in different perspectives from the different generations. We will now move to the theme 3, that is the intergenerational initiatives and how the different generations can work together towards the common goal of climate action. We would like to now talk about our next panelist, who is Jane Goodall. She has been working in, she has a tremendous experience of working with communities over the years and how to engage youth as well as how to engage the elder generation together and bring them in a common platform and give them that space to work together. She has, now I would like to pose this question to her that what is the Root and Shoot project that she has been the founder of? What is it about? What does it do? And tell us more about the Root and Shoot project. And yeah, over to Jane Goodall, ma'am.
I'm representing the aged end of this adult youth spectrum. And I've been watching with great interest a very small baby. So we really are represented the old and the young both. Well, the Roots and Shoots program began in 1991. And it began because in the late 80s, I was traveling around the world trying to raise awareness about the harm that we've inflicted on this planet. Since I was a child, things have got so much worse. The loss of biodiversity, the loss of habitat, the pollution and all the rest of it. And so I was meeting young people who, not surprisingly, had lost hope. They were mostly high school students and university students. And so I began talking to them in all these different countries all around the globe. And some of them were deeply depressed. Some of them were angry and even violent. Most of them were just apathetic. They didn't seem to care. So I asked them, you know, why are you feeling like this? And they all said more or less the same. We feel like this because you've compromised our future and there's nothing we can do about it. Well, as we all know and have admitted now, we have indeed been harming the future of generations to come. But I thought, is it true that there's nothing that they can do about it? No, that's not true. And so the 12 students who began this with me in Tanzania, in Dar es Salaam, they were high school students, and they came from 8 different schools, and they told me all the things they were worried about, the poaching, why wasn't the government doing something about it, the overfishing, the dynamite fishing, street children with no homes, all these different problems that concerned them. So they got together with their friends and we had a meeting of about 30 of us. And out of that meeting came Roots and Shoots, which began in 1991. We decided right from the beginning, the main message would be every single individual matters. And that included animals. Every single individual has a role to play, even if they don't know it yet. Every single individual makes an impact every single day. And unless you're living in abject poverty, you have a choice as to what sort of difference you make. So because everything is interconnected, We decided at that first meeting, okay, each group of roots and shoots would choose three projects between them. One would be to help people, one would be to help animals, one would be to help the environment. And not every member had to do everything, but they all had to share and discuss what they were doing as a whole group. Well, that program is now in 65 countries and growing almost weekly. And we have members now in preschool, and that's really important. That little baby will be able to join soon and just have experience of being in nature. Because when you understand nature, when you learn to love it as a small child, then you grow up to want to protect it. And we also have members in university where the program is very, very strong in every country. And we also now have members who are in their first jobs, who are out in the workforce, our alumni who've been through Roots and Shoots as young people, and they're now out in the big wide world. Last time I went to China, so many people came up to me, adults, said, well, of course I care about the environment. Of course I care about animals. I was in Roots and Shoots program in primary school. And it's like that all around the world. And I think one reason why it's growing so fast is because young people get to choose. It's not top down, it's bottom up. So every young person, having worked out what they care about, having discussed what could be done about it, they then roll up their sleeves and take action. Roots and Shoots is about taking action. And of course, that can include raising funds for victims of earthquakes or hurricanes or something like that. And you'll hear more about what the Roots and Shoots groups are doing from one of our Roots and Shoots youth panelists, Vikram. But one thing that's come out of Roots and Shoots is that the young people have discovered, because we bring them together, unfortunately, mostly virtually, but whenever possible, face to face, we bring different cultures together, different nationalities together. And they've realized that far more important than the color of your skin, your language, your nation, your culture, even your religion, is the fact that we're all human beings. Each one of us matters. Each one of us can make a difference. And another reason we're growing is that we are very inclusive. We want to have partnerships or collaborations with other youth groups who have similar values to us. And sometimes you can make a partnership with a group that is simply about the environment and planting trees. But if they decide to join Roots and Shoots, then they get exposed also to projects to help people and animals. So I think when people say to me, what do you want your legacy to be? I think perhaps starting Roots and Shoots is the most important. And the other one, of course, is science has come to understand that our animals are sentient beings. They have feelings, they have emotions, even in the factory farms. And so because the young people are now exposed to the problems and are able to get together and find ways to solve them and take action, then this truly is making a major difference, making this a better world for all living things.
Thank you so much, Jane Goodall, for your wonderful initiative. And I believe that, yes, every individual can make a difference, and definitely each of us are instrumental in this process. I would like to call upon Vikram, who is the youth representative of the Root and Shoot initiative for UK. And since he has the opportunity to interact and learn from Jane Goodall and learn about the various experiences that she had over the years, what has been your experience of working with Roots and Shoots, and especially about the Roots and Shoots project in UK and over the world? I would like to know about it.
Thank you for introducing me, Dr. Jane Goodall. So working with Jane and working for her institutions and organizations such as Roots and Shoots has taught me how incredibly essential it is to talk to the next generation about the environment and how through molding the minds of children can we also change the minds of their parents as well, affecting that this intergenerational change that we are so desperate for. Roots and Shoots has provided me with some of the most rewarding and fulfilling experiences I can recount on my 22 years on this planet. Not only has the program taken me to some far-flung places, but has also allowed me to do some meaningful work close to home. As part of my university's Roots and Shoots program, we conducted workshops with government-run primary schools across London, where multiple volunteers would sit down with small groups of students and we'd talk to them and hear their thoughts about the issues that the environment is facing and what we together can do to help protect and care for it, practical alternatives and practical solutions that we can do in our everyday lives. During the pandemic, however, we started making online instructional videos and activities students could undertake during lockdown to help wildlife of their local green spaces, such as how to make homemade bird feeders and insect hotels in their very own gardens. Thanks to Roots and Shoots, I was then able to go on the amazing Darwin 200 voyage, which sailed around the UK, where I got to help coordinate and organize seabird and whale surveys, as well as getting to take part in plastic and seaweed surveys in the, some of the most remote corners of the UK. This citizen science data was then used by various organizations, such as CDPC and Sea Watch and the Natural History Museum to better analyze and assess the matters that we're currently looking at. Elsewhere in the UK, Roots and Shoots has also partnered with Andover Trees United to support the planting of more than 8,000 trees by more than 8,000 children. They're also working on surveying projects that aim to inspire youth to connect with and protect nature. Outside the UK, Roots and Shoots has worked in over 60 countries around the world. In Spain, we have supported and supplied the Save Us All product, a project started by Olivia Mandal, a 14-year-old animal activist and climate warrior. She created the jelly cleaner, a utensil made from recycled materials to clean microplastics from the water. Using this incredible innovation, she gives workshops in schools throughout Spain to raise awareness and inspire young people. Her campaign on change.org has 100,000 signatures asking the Spanish government to ban dolphinariums. These are aquariums for dolphins and cetaceans. She was invited to the Spanish Senate by the Vice President to work on a bill that includes a prohibition of breeding, trading, and keeping cetaceans in captivity. Surely, she will present her cause to the entire Spanish Parliament. Championing these incredible young people, do we not only give a voice to those innovative and compassionate minds, but we also inspire more people to live more sustainably. We continue to work with the youth to better empower them to care and protect the forest environment, as seen in our recent project in Australia called Embrace the Wild Project, where we provide young people with resources to establish and protect habitats for urban wildlife. In the United States, we are working with the Hutchings Museum Institute to plant native milkweed to support monarch butterflies, further supporting their population by running campaigns to reduce the use of pesticides in yards and planting pollinating flowers, which of course have many positive cascading effects on the wider ecosystem. But we also appreciate that helping people in tandem with nature is quintessential towards achieving a sustainable and more compassionate future. Our Friends with Donkeys project is a shiny example of promoting youth and indigenous people to better achieve this goal. This project connected young people and the Maasai women on raising awareness about the treatment of working animals related issues in their local communities specific to their region that ultimately benefit both the animal and the people in the long run. And these are one of the many, many projects that are currently being undertaken across the world thanks to Roots and Shoots. Thank you so much for letting me speak today.
Thank you so much, Vikram, for bringing forward the incredible work that Roots and Shoots program has been doing. Definitely, it has been so instrumental in bringing people from diverse backgrounds, from all strata of the society, and from different generations in a common platform. I would like to open this to our YOUNGO representative, who would like to talk about the intergenerational nature-based solution and what the experience has been in their process of work. Jin Tanaka, do you want to go ahead?
Yes, I can do it. So as I explained for the intergenerational nature-based solutions, we need many frameworks for the providing education materials and the capacity buildings and also some community-based mutual understandings. Likewise, nowadays we do the main workings for the any working groups like energies and so many things which is strongly related to nature-based solutions. And that time we strongly focus on to the characteristics on the areas, countries, and regions. And also the youth also necessary to do is like not to engage on the emotional questions and the confrontations, but to offer the counter proposals with jointly think about how we need to face this global challenge in solidarity on a general, in regional basis. I'm convinced that in order to do this, we need to present concrete counter proposals that we based on the scientific evidence. Likewise, we had already have the IPCC solutions, and we have many data, and we have many discussions about the climate change. So that time it's time to consider about to make some proposals and make the frameworks and make some mutual understanding for each of them for mutual nature-based solutions for to work with every single sectors. So that's my point I like to say. And also we also get into the frameworks, not only the UN-CCC, but also the other UN frameworks. And that time, they all time required to and looking for the use proposals with some commitment and some of the engagement for the youth. So that's my point. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Jin. I would like to pass on to someone who has a tremendous experience in working with the nature-based solution, especially in the rural and in the indigenous communities. I would like to call upon Natalie Mangondo from YOUNGO, who is a researcher of Southern Africa Climate Finance Partnership, and she will talk about the intergenerational nature-based solution and how she has experienced over these years in this process.
Good afternoon, everyone. So these conversations can get very high level. So I thought I could just give you an example of one of the projects that I work with in my home country in Zimbabwe in an area called Mangura, which is quite a remote area. So the project is called the Ridziwi Ecological Trust and Research Academy, and that's a very fancy name. But it didn't start off as that. It just started off as a group of concerned women who found that there were people who were poaching wood in their area. And this meant that they had to go further and further away to look for food, look for firewood, and other resources that they need. And as they had to walk further and further away, it meant they were increasingly vulnerable to sexual and physical violence as there's illegal miners in the area as well. And so they came together to create an anti-poaching squad, an all-female anti-poaching squad. But unfortunately, during the restoration of this area with really important indigenous nature, it was discovered that there were gold seams then there in the area. And so this attracted the illegal miners, and that's where I came in to help fund and to finance protective measures in that area. And so it's just a testament that when we don't get everyone involved, because a lot of these miners are young people looking for an income in a country that is economically unstable. So what we did was we got them involved in education programs, ambassador programs. We leveraged the skills of young people to share the work on social media. However, when you know this income was lost, it meant that their elders at home who were depending on them for an income were now left out of the conversation. And so what we did was we leveraged their unique and really important knowledge to, you know, to identify the indigenous species, to share stories about how they were taken care of. And you know, we previously had consultants come in internationally to help us with the restoration, but I tell you the pace increased so much faster when we leveraged the knowledge of the elders within the community. And so that's just a short example of how, you know, when you leave one person out, you actually end up creating another problem. You know, it's just like when we don't notice the importance of a species until it's gone. And so that's why it's so important that we ensure that we remain engaged in a meaningful way and create ownership for everyone across generations. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Natalie. You are doing an incredible work in your community, and definitely I believe that bringing all the generations together from the community and integrating the indigenous knowledge and the experience of the elder generation is definitely instrumental. I now like to call upon my co-moderator, Sophie, to go on to the next theme.
Thank you, Disha, and thank you to all of our speakers. Some phenomenal examples of intergenerational initiatives in practice, tackling climate change and preserving the biodiversity of the world around us by harnessing everyone's knowledge and expertise. So thank you so much for all of those examples. I'd now like to turn a bit closer to home and to explore how we've discussed today the importance of involving many voices in decision making. How have youth voices been involved in UN decision making? How have they been involved so far? So I would like to turn to one of our virtual guests, Jayathma, the UN Secretary General Envoy on Youth. Jayathma, I'd love to hear from you a little bit about your story as a young person who has participated in decision making. And I'd love to hear about how the youth voice has been heard within the United Nations.
Thank you very much, Sophie. Good morning from New York. Very happy to join you here today. And I thank YOUNGO for the invitation, I think for the third consecutive year to be a part of this very important day at the COP. Well, to answer the first part of your question, my work at the UN and my journey, I'm currently serving as the UN Secretary General's Envoy on Youth. I'm the youngest senior official in the Secretary General's cabinet. And a lot of the challenges that the speakers before shared resonate very well with me, and I have also personally experienced many of the challenges that they were referring to. My journey as a youth advocate started back home in Sri Lanka. I'm originally from Sri Lanka, and I lived 19 years of my life during the conflict of my country. So naturally for me, finding solutions for peace building in my country and looking at the intersections between climate, gender equality, unemployment, and peace was very important from a very young age. So this is where sort of my advocacy started and what brought me to where I am today. But I don't want to talk too much about myself as an individual or my individual journey, because I think the challenge here today is what young people as a generation, the largest generation of people in of generation in this planet is facing right now. I think a lot of the speakers spoke to the challenges imposed by the climate crisis, but I also wanted to bring in the perspective how COVID-19 pandemic really exacerbated those challenges and put additional barriers for young people's participation in life when it comes to their employment, when it comes to their education. About 1.5 billion children and young people lost access to education during the pandemic. 1 in 6 young people lost their jobs during the pandemic. And of course, mental health challenges increased because of the restrictions caused by the pandemic as well. So I think when we look at youth participation, we cannot just look at inviting a group of young people to come and speak about the issue or directly sit at a decision-making table and contribute to decisions without looking at how do we holistically empower them economically, educationally, politically, and also with other crucial services that they need, including the realization of their human rights and freedoms as individuals and citizens. So I think it's very important, the conversation that you are having at the COP here today, because I think reversing the impacts of the climate crisis will also help reverse or remove some of these barriers that we are talking about, from gender inequality to unfair, indecent types of employment that young people have to take up just for the sake of survival, and lack of political participation of young people, but particularly young people of the most marginalized and vulnerable groups. But in order for that to happen, I think institutions have to be more open and more honest, and have to create spaces that are resourced, spaces that are safe, and spaces that welcome young people in all their diversity into contributing to these conversations.
Thank you, Jayathma, for that fascinating insight into your own personal journey and some of the barriers that both COVID-19 and more broadly young people face to their participation. I'd like to turn to Fleur to invite you to talk a little bit more about the work that you're doing within the UNFCCC to make COP and all of the UNFCCC negotiations open to young people. We've heard a couple of pointers actually already from the panel about some of the challenges in access. So I'd love to hear from you about what you're doing to enable young people to participate openly and inclusively in COP26 and climate negotiations more broadly.
Thank you very much, and I'm very pleased that the stars aligned, and well, the negotiation stars aligned, and I've been able to actually make it here for the moment. And thank you for the question. And I do know that there have been challenges to access, and I think one of the things that I've tried to stress is that it's important for us, in order for things to go right at COP, there needs to be, we need to be building relationships long before COP, and everything that we do here is built on relationships. And one of the things we try to do is make, where we are able to control and provide greater access to things like the virtual meetings that we've had this year, where it actually did make it easier for us to be able to open those to not only to young people but to observers more broadly, and taking advantage of those moments where you can see that creating that access is actually easier in a mechanism like the COP. It's not always easy, but what we do try to do is also be as open as possible, so that people, this Jayathna's a point about safe environments. I see my role within the Secretariat and with the constituency, with YOUNGO and with others who have who may not yet be in YOUNGO but are approaching the Secretariat, is to help to break down those the barriers and to create to act as a conduit to a process which is often confusing and complex, and we do that by having regular calls with YOUNGO, but also to speak with and to create opportunities where because of where the Secretariat, it's easier for us to open the door. So for instance, being able to create opportunities for YOUNGO to engage with negotiators who are working on areas of interest. And to engage in a way that is useful. So it's not about me directing what gets done. It's about it being a conversation and a two-way exchange. And we don't always get it right, but we do what we can to make sure that the doors that need to be opened are opened, and then it's young people are perfectly capable of once those doors are opening, once those doors are opened to make their own way, and that's been very clear this year in the engagement through the ACE negotiations, the extraordinary organisation of the Conference of Youth, which was, you know, in the circumstances, an amazing achievement, and many of the things that happened. So I think one of the other things is that often young people feel they don't have power, but in fact they do, and it's a matter of using that in a strategic and powerful way as possible, and I think that's also been on display at this COP. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Fleur. I'd like to turn to Hayley now. As one of our YOUNGO youth negotiators, what has been your experience as a young person in participating in COP, and what are the challenges, and how have you overcome them?
Thank you so much. That's a really big question. A lot of YOUNGO folks here probably know that it's definitely not easy to have an opportunity to even share our youth perspective during a lot of these events. But first, I would really like to say that, you know, I work on YOUNGO's ACE Working Group, which is Action for Climate Empowerment. For those of us here that may not know, this is six really strong elements: education, training, public awareness, access to information, international collaboration, and participation in climate solutions, climate action in general. So it's a lot, but they're all really, really important. And that's kind of what we heard today from a lot of the examples that we've been hearing. But these negotiations are ongoing. And something that we have done as a working group is this past year, we organized the 2021 ACE Youth Forum, which was a extremely impressive event, in my opinion. We had a week of ACE to foster intergenerational dialogue, because we do respect and welcome that every single person does need to be at the table, as shared today, but also had a weekend just for youth to come together, share best practices, and connect on ACE in their community, but also discuss policy outcomes that we have now brought into the negotiations here during this whole week, and also in the lead up to COP. As I mentioned before, we have reached out to negotiators very frequently, also with Fleur's help, and we really thank the Secretariat for that. They've been really helpful. But something that is really different is, you know, at the COI closing ceremony, you know, Alok Sharma said, we're all on the same team. And we are, but these teams are unequal. Youth, us, we are not paid for our work to come to this conference to put together policy outcomes to, in a sense, do the job of a negotiator that is paid more money than I probably have ever seen in my whole 23 years of life, which is quite insane to think about. And that's just me as one individual. We, as a team, put together the ACE Youth Forum. We put together weekly working group meetings. We constantly reach out to negotiators, and that's just ACE. There are, I think, what, 17, 20, or 20 something, really large amount of working groups just within YOUNGO, and that doesn't even include all of the youth around the world that are doing actions in their local community. And we're doing this on top of school, on top of working multiple jobs. At least for me in the US, I had to pay my way through university. So I'm in school, I'm in two jobs, I'm also doing two internships and doing this because I'm really passionate about it, but it's not fair, right? It's not the same team. It is not equal. So for me, being in these spaces, it has been really amazing, and I'm really fortunate to even have the opportunity to be here and for the connections. But I think it would be really, really nice for youth to be given that seat at the table, as well as, for example, through the ACE negotiations, we are promoting, you know, an ACE youth focal point to sit and collaborate with a national focal point, not to replace. And I think that's a key thing that we really need to amplify as a youth. We don't necessarily want to replace other people in positions of power, but we want a seat working with them. And that's important because at one point, you know, we are all growing. And when I'm, you know, 40 years old, I'm not going to want to just say, okay, you know, next, I get it. You know, you've worked really hard. And that's not the point. It's to collaborate and to work with youth every single day on all of the actions, but to pay them fairly as well in these spaces and to really listen and include them, not just have, you know, a workshop or say, okay, you know, great, Haley emailed me again with the ACE Youth Forum outcomes for probably the seventh time. Fleur probably knows this, I've emailed them a lot. But we're hearing from negotiators, which is exciting, like, hey, these points are really important. Thank you for emailing them to us. You know, we would be willing to meet with you, of course, after asking, you know, three times, or maybe tracking them down. I don't see anyone here, but I've tracked down a lot of people at COP, which is really exciting, and given that opportunity to other people in my group to do so as well. And I think that's something really special about youth is we're really, really big on sharing the opportunities to speak. So I really want to just take this time to anyone in the ACE working group who's here to stand up or wave or who had a role in any of the ACE events this year so that we can also recognize your work because you are also part of this team together. So yeah, thank you for giving me this space to talk. And I really just appreciate everyone here listening. But one last thing, you know, we're always talking about what can we do. As I said, ACE negotiations are wrapping up today, and something we can do is, you know, send out tweets, send out emails to people that are negotiating to share what you want to see in the new ACE work program. If you are interested in seeing what youth have come together so far to promote, you can check out the ACE Youth Forum outcomes, aceyouthforum.com, a really great website produced by Stephen, who is, I don't know if he's here, but want to give him credit for that because it's an amazing job, again, all for free though, which is the point of, you know, what I've been saying is we are in this together, we do have power and we are using it, but we shouldn't have to be doing it for free. So yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Haley. Jayathma, I know that you wanted to come in with something to say.
Thank you, Sophie. Yes, I just wanted to say two things in wrapping up because I need to leave for another engagement and will not be able to stay for the rest of this dialogue. And again, congratulations to Haley and the ACE team and to YOUNGO for also putting together the Conference of Youth this year and producing your outcomes collectively as a youth movement to put pressure really on our governments and on the negotiators to deliver on the demands of young people. And I appreciate and I also acknowledge the many voluntary contributions that thousands of young people, if not millions of young people, are putting into this work around the world, sometimes also despite threats against their safety and their lives in certain cases and in countries where, you know, youth activism or speaking up is not welcomed. However, the two points I wanted to mention is one, working with the United Nations or working inside the United Nations being such a large bureaucratic organization, but also working with governments and other institutions, I've observed two things. The first thing is that there is, even in cases where there is genuine will for youth empowerment and youth engagement, there is a lack of knowledge as to how to do that, or lack of awareness as to how to properly and meaningfully engage with young people. Because I often see institutions wanting to engage with young people, but probably thinking of it as a good experience for the young people who are involving or teaching young people how the institutions work or run, instead of looking at them as experts or looking at them as equal partners who can contribute to the work, same as a minister, as same as a CEO of a company, as same as a technical expert on a specific issue. So I think when we talk about capacity building, we also need not only capacity building for youth to engage with institutions, but really also in the capacity building of institutions to understand how to work with young people, to understand how to be flexible and adaptable, to adapt to the ways that young people want to engage themselves and not ask them to organize themselves like us or like the institutions. So I think this gap needs to be filled. And this is a little bit of what I try to do also internally in the UN through the youth strategy by developing specific indicators and specific frameworks so that the UN as an institution adhere to those principles before they think of engaging with young people. Now, the second part of that is in many cases, though, we see that even the genuine political will to engage young people is not there. Because at the end of the day, it's a question of sharing power, right? And often in cases when when there are people who want your voices not to be heard, or there is actual discrimination and oppression happening, it is less likely the group that is trying to suppress your voices will give you the resources or will create a seat for you at the table or will try to invite you to be in spaces where they genuinely do not want you to be in. So unfortunately, a lot of the work that we still need to do in the youth space remains really claiming that seat and claiming that power and claiming that space. I think this is where also when we talk about intergenerational partnerships, not seeing it as a binary of generational partnership between the young and the old, but also looking at how we look horizontally within the different groups of young people. Who are the young people within the institutions already that can be our allies? Who are the young people who are outside protesting on the streets who can be our allies? And really looking at partnerships in a very holistic way and also coming up with different strategies to approach different processes and ways of change is important. Again, congratulations to all the young people who made it so far and made so many sacrifices to be here. Please count me in as your ally and your partner within the United Nations, and I'm always looking forward to ways to help you and support you in your work. Thank you.
Thank you, Jayathma, for those closing comments. And I really am struck by the point that you made around capacity building in institutions as well as in individuals. And so I'd like to open back up to our youth panelists here in the room and ask if you had one thing that you could say that you would like to see the UNFCCC do differently, what would it be? And I'm going to come down to the end. Natalie, would you like to kick us off? To create better spaces for young people in decision making.
Yeah, I think they can do more to recognize the intersectionality. And so you might have young people, but it might be largely from the global north, or it might be largely people who already have access to these spaces through other means, not as a young person. So I think you need to do more to recognize the intersectional nature of exclusion.
Thank you, Natalie. Jin.
Thanks so much. So it's great place for the to make the capacities and the mix opportunities and the mix to the more rising the more peoples into the youth. And so now, So now our country also having the sessions for talking about wars, talking about waters, about the next year's April, and so I'm planning to set up to the youth forums and try to connect to the any youth forums for it. Likewise, we have the many organizations for the UN decision making process, and we can make it for the each part for the youth coalition members to set up to that to get more unite to the more youth voices. So thanks for the inviting to these great sessions. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Jin. Gabby.
Yo estoy totalmente de acuerdo con lo que dijo Jayathma, que es importante. Estoy de acuerdo con lo que dijo Jayathma, que es importante que las juventudes tengan un espacio activo de participación también para las decisiones. Si se logra eso a nivel internacional, puede ser una práctica más fácil de replicar en otros países. Se normaliza. El momento en el que tú aceptas que las juventudes del sur global y del norte global pueden participar en el proceso de decisión aquí en la COP, empiezas a normalizar eso para un futuro. Lo que pienso es que la realidad entre el sur global y el norte global es muy diferente, y aunque la puerta esté abierta, no todos podemos hacer el camino para entrar. Yo estoy aquí por una iniciativa de GoFundMe. O sea, fue gente normal como ustedes que creyó que podía yo estar aquí, quien pagó mi viaje aquí. No fue mi gobierno, no fue mi organización porque no habían fondos. Fue personas. Y para concluir, me gustó mucho la intervención y quería compartir la experiencia de Ecuador. Nosotros reconocimos los derechos de la naturaleza porque reconocemos que el ciclo de vida es parte de la naturaleza. Y a través de eso reconocemos que hay límites para explotar los recursos. Ya sabemos, incluso desde la ciencia, que estamos conectados también con el ambiente. Y somos nosotros los representantes legales, es decir, los adultos, quienes podemos exigir esos derechos. Y ahora hay muchas barreras para llevarlo eso a cabo, pero si tenemos el espacio para compartir esas experiencias, también desde el sentir pensar de la juventud, podríamos generar un impacto.
Thank you so much, Gabby. So now we are very happy to inform you that we are joined by Roberto Cingolani, the Minister of Ecological Transition of Italy and the organizer of Youth for Climate Summit at the pre-COP. So we are very happy to have you, sir, and we would like to know that Italy has been so substantial in supporting youth involvement in the entire process. So what your experience has been in the involvement of youth, and how do you envision the involvement of youth in the next few years?
So guys, thank you for the invitation. It's a big pleasure to be here. So let me tell you, first of all, a personal disclosure, I'm not a politician, okay? I'm minister by chance for a few months. I was appointed in February this year, and our legislation will last till at maximum till February 23rd. I'm a technical guy. I was 37 years in science. I'm a scientist, I'm a physicist, been working on nanotechnology, sustainable technology, material chemistry, bio-nanotechnology. That was my life for essentially forever. Over the last few years, I was the Chief Technology Innovation Officer of the largest aerospace and defense company in the country. We did primarily satellites and new technology for green aircraft, stuff like that. And then all of a sudden, I was required to occupy this uncomfortable chair of the ecological transition in the country. I say uncomfortable because this is a new minister, new ministry that has been formed this year, primarily merging all the climate-related issues and energy. So in some sense, my position at the moment is in charge of managing the energy transition and the ecological transition together. And so I found myself involved in the presidency of G20 and the story that you know, because of the story of the last 6-7 months, where, by the way, I met you guys at the pre-COP and at the Youth for Climate event. On top of that, I should say I'm father of three children. My first boy is a chemical engineer and is working in a COVID-related testing systems. My second child is a chemist and is working on green batteries. And my third one is small, is only 12, and is still at school, but there's some sensitivity about the future of the environment because it belongs to the 12 years generation, you know, so is now playing with the social and watching TV and so on and so forth. Now, why I would like to spend a few minutes to tell you what I'm doing, because I hope this will be somehow inspirational for most of you. I like, as a father, the fact that my kids are protesting. I think the protest keeps all of us awake, but I also like that my kids propose something. And my message, my strong message, is that going from protesting to proposing means that you have to be for a long time studying, increasing your competencies, and somehow accepting the idea that one main vector of improvement, one main vector of peace for the future will be science and technology. I'm sure that if a good solution will come, this will come by new technologies that in the future should help us accelerating decarbonization, accelerating all the environmental problems. And I will tell you in 1 minute what I'm planning to do in Italy within the so-called recovery and resilience plan. But the second thing I want to tell you, as I come from a very normal family, I was not rich by origin, I'm not rich now, I will never be rich. The second point is that I'm firmly convinced, especially now in this position, that there is but no means possibility to treat climate change separated by global inequalities. This to me is possibly the most difficult challenge we have to face. If we don't fix the global inequalities, we will not succeed completely in fighting the climate change. And this was actually what I was trying to do in my mandate as a minister and in my contribution to the G20 and COP26 work. At this moment, my country is investing $210 billion in the next 5 years for the recovery plan within in the framework of the Next Generation EU plan, so European initiative. So out of those $210 billion for the next 5 years, about 70 will be dedicated entirely to the ecological transition. So this is exactly what I'm doing now. So the reason to call a scientist as a minister, though for a couple of years, not more, it is because it was needed some competence to write a grand challenge project. And this will be dedicated to three main pillars. The first pillar is, how can we directly reduce carbonization? That means changing primary energy production, electrification, swapping from coal to renewable, and making a very difficult technological problem. We have to install 70 billion watt of new renewable power plants in the country, and of course, phasing out correspondingly fossil fuel related power generators. For doing this, of course, we aim at producing more than 70% of our electricity in the next few years, just to make it real the fact that we can mobilize cars with batteries and not with combustion fuels, that we can swap hard-to-abate manufacturing systems. You know, Italy is a quite powerful manufacturing country. We produce 30% of our greenhouse gas by manufacturing. This has to be changed. Means electrifying paper, tissue, steel, cement. And in order to electrify those things, you need to change completely the infrastructure. We have 37 million cars. And if you want to swap into an electric mobility, we need to have maybe 50,000 charging stations, a smart grid, 150 gigawatt of renewable energy, gigafactory, so a factory producing batteries. This transformation is historical. And it's a large-scale infrastructural transformation. The second pillar in the battle for the recovery plan is indirect reduction of greenhouse gas. And that means, strictly speaking, circularity. We are launching about 20 billion programs for circularity. That includes making our agricultural farm completely autonomous in terms of energy generation and employment and exploitation of biomass and animal dejection to create biogas. That means launching about 50 new programs, national programs, for the end of waste cycle, so transforming about 2 million tons of organic waste into biogas, and transforming plastic into biofuels, and also producing compost by the organic materials that can replace nitrogen-based fertilizers. This is a massive technology action. And the third one is passive decarbonization. That means a natural way to trap carbon dioxide by using nature. So we are reforestation is the first. We're planting for about 0.3 billion trees in the main cities, recovering the status of the coast, recovering the status of the sea around the coast, and of course recovering the status of the land. This is about 18 billion investment for 5 years, because if we have a good land, a good sea, a good green, carbon capture gets really effective. So you see, moving in parallel, direct, indirect, and passive decarbonization means tackling climate change in a very parallel and effective way. Of course, this needs a lot of science, a lot of new technologies, a lot of commitment, and a lot of money, obviously. And we hope by this we can accelerate the process. Italy produces only 1% of the global carbon dioxide, and we're approximately 1% of the global population, maybe a bit more. So we're somehow linear. All we have to do super linear. Europe produces 8% of the total carbon dioxide. So you might wonder, okay, you're investing all that effort to cut 8% only? The answer is yes. First of all, we have to do it first. Second, we need to give the good example. Third, we have to develop best practices. Fourth, associated to that action, we have another action. We have to contribute substantially to the reduction of the global inequalities. Italy this year has triplicated the financial effort to support vulnerable countries. And this is just decided, so it's a brand new thing. And I think as a very last issue, I want to mention that I've learned a lot by the Youth for Climate event, where I met you guys, by the way, and in a number of initiatives we had with the young people that I could meet over the last couple of months. As I said, more as a father than as a scientist and eventually a minister. So we have decided to invest our money to make the Youth for Climate event forever, make it periodic every year, to anticipate the COP, to give to the young people a free forum to develop proposals. I ask you, this is my deal, I ask you one thing. We go from protest to proposal, and if you like this, we try to create, we create a digital hub for you, and we make every year one global event, Youth for Climate, where you can meet all together, discuss, and produce a proposal. We tried this year for the first time in Milan. I know this was the first time, so maybe the machine should improve. But I'm sure that in the next years, if we can provide this forum to all of you, the proposals will be stronger and stronger. And we need you in the governance of the process. That's my message for today, and thank you very much for inviting me.
Thank you so much, Minister. So, extremely insightful, and definitely the Ministry of Transitional Italy and the kind of work that we have seen in Italy already, and we envision that the upcoming years will be really fruitful in the youth development and youth participation. So now I would like to move on to one of the most important and most weighted sessions, that is the question and answer sessions of the this event. So we open the floor for our audience to ask any questions, any clarification, anything that you would like to share from your communities, and please go ahead. You need to click the button on your mic and we would go accordingly.
I think my mic is on, sorry. So I am speaking here personally, but have been involved with the organization of COP26 as well, the yearly event that's put on by YOUNGO. And my question, especially to the Italian minister here, is if you're talking about going from protest to proposal, in your own words, and emphasizing that you need to do all this learning, I, as a young person, feel somewhat offended by that, to be honest, in that we've done this learning. We know what we're talking about. And so you don't need to be a PhD student to know what you're talking about when it comes to climate change. As it happens, I am also a PhD student. So I really struggle with this sort of patronizing way in which youth involvement is, we are here to give you a space to educate yourselves. We've done that educating. And if you reflect on everything that the speakers have been saying here so far, it's not that we need the space to learn, it's that we need the space to actually have a seat at the table where the decisions are taken. And so I think an event in Milan, great. I was not there. I was busy organizing my own youth event, where we then presented a global youth statement that we've given to the COP presidency. And so what we need is not more education of young people who are already there, who are already very much inside the process in this insider-only event. What we need is for people to actually read that statement and then make it into negotiations.
Hello. Yeah, thank you. I never mentioned the word education. I never said there is an event to educate anybody. I said this is a self-organized event, will be your own forum that you will manage on your own. That's all. And the fact that I said we need to study, I'm sorry, this is a misunderstanding. I didn't say you are ignorant and you have to study. If I wanted to say this, I would have said. I said something completely different. Is that the situation is so complex that we need to study. I mean, I am the first who's studying. because I've never found in my life before, as a scientist, as I mentioned, such a complicated problem which sociology, anthropology, history, chemistry, atmosphere, geology, physics, they're all together. There's no book for that. We need to write the books. But the two things are totally separated. The fact that we have two study solutions, it was dealing with technology. That was my, let's say, introduction. And the fact that I'm happy if we can provide a self-organized free forum to the young people for new proposals has nothing to do with the education. So I hope this clarifies. I didn't come here to teach anybody. I mean, I resigned as a professor in the university 10 years ago because I don't like make teaching on the other side of the board. Okay, no problem at all. I hope this clarifies. By the way, sorry, because we believe in this approach. You see, it's Italian taxpayer money that is put in this initiative to let all young people from all over the world to propose something. It has nothing to do with teaching. It's really, I see this as an opportunity. That's why I told you about my children, by the way. That was exactly the spirit. Hope you believe me.
Thank you so much, Minister, sir. I totally, not only me, we, the young generation, totally appreciate the kind of work that Italy is doing. And we believe that it will provide the platform that it has provided this time. And we are very hopeful. For the problem of time, and since we are on the top of an hour, we want to, we are extremely sorry that we have completed the time. And it's, okay, so since we would like to pass on to the speaker. Yeah, please go ahead, Chandel.
Hello, this is Art.
Here.
Okay. Hi, thank you for letting me speak. I really enjoy that we organized this platform and everything, but my little concern was that the minister came in and he didn't give Haley a chance to speak. This is supposed to be a youth platform. I don't know how it happened. It may have been accidental, but allow the youth to participate in the space that they're allowed to participate. It is a problem. You can't perpetuate these systems where the minute somebody important comes in, we just forget who we are as humans, because Haley was a panelist on this. She's representing Younger. We picked her, and she didn't get to speak because the minister came in, and it seems like we're just going to pretend that didn't happen. So I don't know who did that, but yes.
Yeah, thank you so much for that. I really think that's an important point. I did really want to answer that last question about also what I would like to see in the UNFCCC processes, but also to the minister's point really quick, it's not that we want to just produce proposals and be called upon to share ideas. We want to collaborate. We want to be at the table. We don't want to just produce a sheet of paper that has their ideas and say, yep, there you go, hope you think about it. We want to be in the room collaborating, and I encourage, you know, at future pre-COP conferences, Youth for Climate events, that is actually what the priority is. And I think that's what the point over here, and I'm sorry I didn't get your name, was trying to make, is that it's not just about coming together. We come together. We produce COI. We have working groups. We're already in this together. We want to be at the table. We want to be collaborating. And that's my point about what I'd like to see from the UNFCCC as well, is lead by example. Bring youth into the UNFCCC delegations, bring youth into these spaces together, and show parties that it's not that hard to open up a spot for youth, and that's where the money should be going. It should be going there together so that we can collaborate as a team. And we want to be able to bring that back to governments. We want to say, we worked on this. I worked on this statement with my U.S. representative, and that U.S. representative and me together can go back to my community and share it with the other government leaders around, so that we can all be in this together. And I think the UNFCCC has that opportunity to be the leaders and show that it's really not that hard to give us a seat at the table and to include us and collaborate with us. I don't want to put on an ACE Youth Forum every year just to collect ideas that get cast aside, right? We want to know that our work that we do together is something that we can share in the room. So yeah, and thank you again, Shondell. I think that was really important, and I really appreciate you for giving me the floor.
Thank you. you so much, Haley. This is what happens when like there are differences, but we are binded by the common goal of fighting for against climate change and being together in this journey of climate action. And we look forward to having this not just ending it here, but having this intergenerational inquiry and this equity carry forward in the next days. And we are very thankful for everyone who have joined us. Extremely thankful to our panel, Roberto Sir, Fleur Newman, Haley Campbell, Gabby, Jane. I think the others have left, but I'm so thankful, and the wonderful audience, you have been so wonderful. Thank you so much for joining us, and have a great day ahead.